see all of you. And Judge Gould is appearing from Seattle. Can you hear us, Judge Gould?
Yes, Chief Judge Thomas. Good afternoon.
Great. This is the time set for argument in the case of Alston versus NCAA. And I'll proceed with the appellants.
Thank you, Chief Judge Thomas, and may it please the court. I'm Seth Waxman, representing the appellants, and with the court's permission, I'm aspiring to reserve 7 minutes for rebuttal in this case. The judgment below is starkly inconsistent with this court's decision 4 years ago in O'Bannon and would redefine college sports as we know them. In O'Bannon, addressing a materially identical challenge to virtually the same amateurism rules, this court held that those rules are pro-competitive and can be set aside only if the plaintiff bears the heavy burden of proving the existence of an alternative that is substantially less restrictive, yet virtually as effective without significant costs. The plaintiffs did not adduce such evidence, and the alternative that the court adopted is certainly not supported by it. Amateurism, as reflected in the NCAA's rules and recognized in O'Bannon, prohibits athletics-related compensation beyond covering legitimate expenses or modestly recognizing achievement. Yet the district court's injunction would permit colleges, sponsors, and boosters to recruit athletes with promises of internships that pay hundreds of thousands of dollars in cash, new cars to get to class. Colleges can promise to pay thousands of dollars in cash each year that any student athlete remains academically eligible to play, and can also promise other lavish benefits, unlimited according to the court's injunction, so long as they are somehow nominally related to education. O'Bannon should have barred this suit from the outset, but in any event, the trial court committed both legal and plain factual error at both steps 2 and 3 of the rule of reason analysis. First, as to step 2, the legal error was twofold. Echoing Board of Regents, rather, this court held in O'Bannon that materially identical compensation regulations were pro-competitive because they, quote, preserve the popularity of the NCAA's product by promoting its understanding of amateurism.
Mr. Waxman,
yes, Judge Smith.
I don't want to interrupt you too much.
Well,
here,
please,
but by all means.
I've
got to tell you, I have been very troubled by our O'Bannon case for a different reason than you, apparently. I would be very interested in your take on what is the relevant market here. It seems that the O'Bannon court, our court, and the district court, in obedience to that, concluded that basically what the consumer wants controls the market for those who are aspiring to be paid more. That's my take on it. And I'm troubled because I think the Supreme Court's Topco Associates case, our Paladin Associates case, DC Circuit Smith versus Pro Football, and so on, suggests that that's not appropriate, that we really ought not to be measuring the market in terms of some other market, i.e., in this case, consumer demand, but rather in terms of the offended sellers. I don't think anybody disagrees that you've got an antitrust violation here. The question is, where does the rule of reason apply? How does it apply? And the market consideration, I think, is principal, isn't it? What's your take on that?
So I think, Judge Smith, you are right that O'Bannon did hold that the pro-competitive benefit that essentially that the defendants established at step 2 and that this court affirmed as warranting putting the burden on the plaintiffs to move to step 3 was in fact that the NCAA rules create a differentiated product, amateur, collegiate, intercollegiate athletics, that is pro-competitive because it provides for consumer choice. And of course, that's exactly what the Supreme Court explained in its Board of Regents decision when it said that the amateurism rules achieve the pro-competitive purpose of, quote, maintaining the integrity of collegiate sports as a distinct and attractive product, thereby widening consumer choice. So you're quite right that this court, echoing O'Bannon, and the same has been true for the decisions that we've cited in the 3rd, 5th, 7th, and 10th circuits.
Let's talk about Regents. I know you're a Supreme Court scholar, so you'll have no trouble with Regents. that was a long time ago. I actually had a cousin who was Solicitor General then before you that argued that very case.
Yes, one of the greatest.
And I am troubled by the concept that somehow a competition between two, if you will, two competing athletic associations who want football rights somehow governs this case. I know that some of the dicta of the court there is important, and it talked about the product and so on, and I think the district court here also picked up on that idea. But Regents doesn't really control here, does it?
Well, we think that O'Bannon controls here, and O'Bannon held as a matter of law that the NCAA's rules that make possible a differentiated product that is wildly popular satisfies the pro-competitive purpose of step two. Now, I will say that we took the position in front of Judge Wilkin that stare decisis and res judicata required a dismissal of this complaint. But in any event, the court denied that, and we sought to put on evidence showing that the market is in fact not the market that she concluded was the market in O'Bannon, but rather that the market was in fact what the Supreme Court has recognized in the American Express case as a multi-sided market that involves more than just athletes on the one side, on the one hand, and consumers on the other.
Well, if that's true, as you know well, the district court in this case found that, I want to be sure and get this correct here, that, for example, the changes that the NCAA made in its bylaws involved no analysis concerning consumer demand. It also held that when there was increased compensation after 2015 for the athletes, apparently not only did it not reduce consumer demand, but rather the demand went up. Under the circumstances, what's the best evidence that you have that the district court did not already consider that amateurism really does play a role in increasing demand for this product?
So I don't think that even the district judge, I want to address the judge's findings or belief that there was some materially substantial change in the rules between the time that O'Bannon was decided and the time this case was tried, because as we've indicated and tried to explain in our reply brief, the answer is absolutely not. There is no material difference in the rules that existed at the time that O'Bannon was tried and argued and decided by this court and the time this case was tried, or for that matter now. But even Judge Wilkin, both in O'Bannon and here, held that the defendants had satisfied their step two burden, because there is no question that the product that we provide, amateur intercollegiate sports, is pro-competitive because it provides for consumer choice. Under the Sherman Act, that is the definition of a pro-competitive purpose, differentiated product that consumers value. Now, the question is not whether if we had changed one rule or another, our product would become somewhat more appealing or somewhat less appealing. We're entitled to ample latitude. We don't have to show that every time the NCAA decides to make a change in some a restriction on an expense or not, that we do a survey about whether or not it will increase consumer interest or not. That is not the way that what the NCAA considers when it is making rules. It is pursuing its fundamental principle that characterizes its product, which is that student athletes are students first and amateurs, and what the no pay for play principle stands for is that as amateur intercollegiate athletics, students are not paid either to play or to be induced to pay, and except with respect to reimbursement of what this court in O'Bannon said over and over and over again, are legit the reimbursement or accounting for legitimate expenses. The ideal that the NCAA promotes is that participation as a student and a student athlete should be cost free. And that's what our amateurism rules permit.
I know that's your position. The district court had some doubts about that, but let's talk about something that the district court didn't consider, but I think is relevant in terms, at least in my analysis, of ultimately what we're dealing with here. You're very familiar with the California Fair Pay to Play Act. You're very familiar, probably even testified before Congress, that Congress is considering something. 30 states, if I understand correctly, are also considering something. Wouldn't the ability of promising young athletes, football and basketball players in this case, to be paid potentially millions of dollars for their NILs completely undercut the NCAA's conception of amateurism?
So the position of the NCAA is that the California legislation, at least in its current form, and right, as the court is familiar, the legislature is going to reexamine it,
right,
would be entirely inconsistent with the NCAA's principles of amateurism because, among other things, it would require the NCAA to permit the very payments that this court properly held in O'Bannon were inconsistent. Now, as we've explained in our supplemental brief and as is reflected in the California legislation, I will say we think that the California legislation is unconstitutional. We haven't challenged it yet because we are hopeful that California and other states will accommodate their legislation to the...
You think it's unconstitutional? Help me with that.
I think under this circuit's Miller decision and under South Dakota versus Wayfair, it plainly violates the Dormant Commerce Clause. We're not here to argue that. I hope we never have to bring that suit. Our point is we have a working group, as you know, it's cited in our supplemental brief, which is looking at this issue. And what the working group is doing is trying to draw a distinction between the monetization of name, image, and likeness that is, in fact, related to or incident to a student athlete's athletic participation, which under principles of amateurism will not be permitted, and ways in which a student athlete can monetize her or his name, image, and likeness that are unrelated to that. And I commend to your reading attention, if you haven't already looked at it, the working group report, which goes into some careful analysis about the tripwires on either line, and that's a process that's ongoing. But
what you're saying to me confirms what I thought, which is that if it is constitutional and if it's applied, it destroys amateurism as the NCAA defines it, right?
Well, you're referring to the California
correct,
legislation?
Correct, the California Act. I don't know what the rest of
our position is that the California legislation in its current form is flatly inconsistent with the product that the amateurism principles that we now offer. Now, if it turns out that we are wrong and it is applied to us and it is not unconstitutional, or perhaps Congress enacts national legislation
right
in this regard, it is surely not an antitrust violation to comply with the positive legislative enactment.
And I wasn't thinking it was an antitrust violation. I was thinking it would undercut perhaps some of your defenses in the rule of reason analysis if it was applied in the way that it currently exists.
Judge Smith, if it is applied in the way that it is currently legislated, a subsequent challenge under the Sherman Act would not be precluded under stare decisis right by either O'Bannon or a decision in this court. May I reserve the balance of my time?
Of course.
Sorry I took up all this time here, but it,
I
want to ask the questions I have.
I think I can speak for all of us. We all came a long way to participate in this hearing, and whatever questions your honors have is fine with us.
May it please the court, Steve Berman on behalf of the plaintiffs. I'm sharing my time with my co-counsel, Mr. Kessler, who is going to address our appeal, and I will address the defense of the injunction. May it please the court, a single court decision cannot invalidate or immunize a business practice for all time. O'Bannon does not immunize the NCAA for additional and future antitrust scrutiny based on materially different facts. And Judge Wilkin had before her materially different facts than were present in O'Bannon. So there is no res judicata and there is no stare decisis. Mr. Waxman told you that the injunction would radically change the way that the NCAA conducts its business, that there would be new cars and $100,000 payments. That is flat out wrong. What the injunction did was very limited. It said the NCAA's rules are too restrictive when it comes to educational benefits. And it said you go and provide educational benefits, and you do so in an amount that is no less than what you already pay cash for athletic achievement. It is then up to the conferences to decide how much they're going to make available in academic benefits. And every single witness that I examined at trial, I had every university president up there, and I asked them a very simple question. If the rules are lifted because we win, are you going to do what's in the best interest of the conference? Yes. Are you going to start paying people unlimited cash disguised as educational benefits? No. We're going to act prudently. And that's what the antitrust laws are about.
That's kind of a figure of speech. Isn't Mr. Waxman correct in this extent? That we've got, in the current environment, you have universities whose major financial thrust, if you will, is athletics. They make millions and millions and millions of dollars. They pay the coaches millions and millions and millions of dollars. The question seems to be, what's the appropriate amount to pay for the people who earn it in the first place, the workers, if you will? I know your position on that. The NCAA is saying that, if I understand it correctly, if you want this product, you've got to have a differentiation between the pros and the colleges. And what they say they have proposed and has been, they think, can find under the rule of reason are awards related to education, but not those that are not. And they feel that Judge Wilkins' injunction permits enough wiggle room that you can have payments outside the context of education. Do you disagree with what they're saying on that?
I do disagree with that.
Okay.
Because the injunction only requires the NCAA or the conferences to focus on educational-related benefits, nothing more.
But how is that defined? For example, if you have an outstanding athlete that you want to recruit and somebody else wants to recruit the same athlete, don't you have some, if you will, wiggle room within the injunction to entice the athlete to come to your school versus another school in a financial way? Doesn't the injunction provide for that?
I don't see how it does. All the injunction says is, with respect to educational benefits, as opposed to educational-related academic awards, but as to benefits, you're allowed to go out and offer graduate school, right? Graduate school is defined, and the tuition is the tuition. So if you're offering someone graduate school, there's no wiggle room. You're allowed to offer vocational schools. Vocational schools are a defined item. It's not like you can somehow say, we're going to pay you extra cash to go to vocational school. The vocational school cost is the vocational school cost. So I don't think there's any wiggle room. All the court is trying to do is to say the following. Look, you've engaged in anti-competitive conduct. That she found. Second, are the rules more restrictive than necessary? And she had abundant evidence that they were. We have now a situation from O'Bannon where they're making tens of thousands of dollars in payments under the student assistance fund disbursements, sometimes $50,000 to a player for insurance. That hasn't hurt demand. So how can
perhaps that's something we ought to talk about. That insurance, of course, is designed, if I understand it correctly, to protect the athlete when he or she might be injured and never be able to become a pro and earn more money. So that clearly has really nothing per se to do with educational benefits, does it?
That's right. That's the point. The point of the new evidence was there's all kinds of payments that are being made unrelated to educational benefits that cross the line of COA. Remember, before O'Bannon, the cash was limited, compensation was limited to GIA, grant and aid. We sued then, saying that's unlawful. They then went up to COA. The NCAA had taken the position prior to that if you went over GIA, it would destroy amateurism. Now they're paying COA, and what Judge Wilkin had, and I think probably the most important economic evidence, is she had what the professors call, Professors Rashers and Knoll, a natural economic experiment. We had cost of attendance post-O'Bannon, these are all post-O'Bannon facts, showing that tens of thousands of dollars are going to student athletes, demand is not going down, demand is increasing. So in those circumstances, how could it possibly be the case that these rules aren't too broad?
Before you sit down, I want to ask you, as I did Mr. Waxman, what is the relevant market here?
Well, the relevant market has not been appealed.
It's important to me in terms of my analysis.
But I think the relevant market is the market that was the market in O'Bannon and that was the market here, is the market for plaintiffs' athletic services.
Should O'Bannon be reheard en banc?
I don't know how you do that. I mean,
it's really easy.
It's been decided.
You get a vote and you do it.
There's no appeal of the market definition. So you would be sua sponte raising an issue
If we thought that O'Bannon got the law wrong, a judge on our court can sua sponte call it en banc. If you get the vote, you can do it. So my question to you is, did the court get it wrong? Trying to follow, Judge Wilkin tried to follow O'Bannon, but did O'Bannon get the law wrong with respect to the relevant market?
No, I think the O'Bannon court, based on Professor Rasher and Professor Knoll, same economists that were in this case, correctly defined the market. And therefore, I don't think there's any need for a reexamination of the market.
So you had an amicus brief filed on your behalf that suggests that it really was wrong, that in fact it turns monoscopy law on its head, that the sellers are not protected. It's really only the consumers. Do you disagree with your amicus on that?
I do, Your Honor.
Okay, all right.
I see my time is running out, so let me just end with this note. I'm here defending the courts allowing additional educational-related benefits. And the district court's remedy, which eliminates artificial caps on educational-related benefits, should actually be welcomed by the NCAA, because you're going to make students better students by offering them more educational opportunities. In fact, the defendant's expert admitted that adding educational benefits would promote better outcomes for these student athletes. Now, given that, I don't think that there is an error in the injunction as tailored by Judge Wilkin. Thank you.
Thank you.
May it please the court, my name is Jeffrey Kessler. I'm also representing the plaintiffs, and I'm going to focus my attention on our cross appeal on the injunctive relief, and I'd like to reserve 3 minutes for rebuttal time on the cross appeal claim, if that is acceptable to the
court.
Is
it the boss?
Certainly, go ahead.
Thank you.
Yeah, but manage your own time. If you run out, you run
Thank you, understood. Thank you. There was three problems with the relief granted by the court once the violation was established. The most fundamental problem was the court confused the determination of less restrictive alternatives with the issue on relief and felt the need to craft her injunction to embody the less restrictive alternative. And what's wrong with that is that it puts the court in the process of deciding what the market outcome should be. And actually what the antitrust relief requires is to eliminate the restraint and let competition decide what the market outcome should be.
But didn't Judge Wilkin, though, leave a great deal of discretion for the parties to come back to the court to fill in the blanks, if you will? I know she specifically invited the NCAA to do that, and I assume that was true for you as well, basically to have an on-the-ground reevaluation as the decree was applied. Isn't that correct?
Yes, she did, Your Honor. And I have no problem with that aspect of her decree. In fact, I think it's totally appropriate. What my objection is that because she found the violation, we are not with just respect to the limitations on competition for education-related benefits, but she also found on her summary judgment, actually, which was not challenged, that the restrictions were overbroad for non-educated related compensation because all the evidence was one way that you could provide such additional compensation without hurting consumer demand, which was the test she applied. She then did not give any relief on that aspect of it because of her concern from the O'Bannon ruling that there was going to be this quantum leap. So she decided, well, I'm then going to have an injunction that's just based on my less restrictive alternative, which tries to avoid that. What we believe is the proper way to look at this is, once you have the violation, what she should have done is what we had proposed in our first proposal for injunctive relief, our first alternative, which is that you enjoin the NCAA from having rules to limit any type of compensation to the athletes for their services, just the NCAA, but you then have competition by the conferences, which gives you the competitive outcome that would then decide what's the most efficient market outcome
but in terms of that. With respect, counsel, the NCAA makes the point, at least from their perspective, that amateurism and the way it's structured is key to the product, I think it's referred to, that's being set. You're talking about just basically pure competition. That may be a valuable thing to do in certain settings. To that degree, I think Regent does have some relevance there, where they recognize in the television context, that if you don't have certain, if you will, governing rules, you don't have it at all. If you don't have something like the NCAA to govern the football conferences and so on, who's in charge?
So, Your Honor, to be very clear, we do not challenge the NCAA's right to have eligibility rules that you must be students. We do not challenge that they should have rules for safety. We don't challenge they should have rules against boosters or agents or many other things in this case. What we think is appropriate is look at the findings of fact, which, of course, are under a clear error standard. The court did not find the broad amateurism justification.
How could she have done differently than she did under O'Bannon? Whether O'Bannon's right is another matter, but under O'Bannon, didn't she have to do at least limiting to educational-related expenses, at least as she saw it?
No, Your Honor, I don't think so, because while she was required to follow the legal principles of O'Bannon, The record was massively different. And specifically, what the fact record showed, which is what she went from, is that there was tremendous evidence that the NCAA had made the quantum leap since O'Bannon, had been offering numerous benefits. One of the ones is the one Your Honor mentioned, to allow for the insurance for professional work Another one was the thousands of dollars of awards you could get for going to a bowl game or some other athletic achievement. Another one was the use of SAF funds to pay for items that had nothing to do with education at all. At one point, they paid for lawyers for the athletes. And this has become pervasive. And what the...
So is your point, since that wall has been breached, there's no wall anymore, Humpty Dumpty's gone?
Because that wall was breached and all the evidence showed it did not adversely affect consumer demand. That's the second part of the analysis. That gave her a factual basis, which she found, just like, by the way, she rejected the integration defense in its entirety, as a matter of fact, in this case, even though that was factually decided in O'Bannon was there. This is a new record, and she found, and unless there's a clearly erroneous basis, which we don't think they've established, to go to the broader injunction, then the only thing she found was there's a ban on unlimited payments to athletes, which she then held these rules were far more restrictive than necessary, both on educated-related and non-educated-related. That's what the determination was on summary judgment that's not even appealed here. So they can't even challenge that.
So under your conception of what the proper scope of the injunction is, would you say that any NCAA rules prohibiting students individually from licensing their names, likenesses, and images would be prohibited or not?
Okay, well, that's not an issue we've raised in this case because names, images, and likenesses are not there. My view is that they could, if in a future case, they probably could not sustain name, image, and likeness.
By whom do you mean?
But it's not part of our class. We don't have a class limited to that or raising that.
No, but you were talking about the appropriate rules that the NCAA could still enact. And my question is, under your conception of the injunction, as you would have the district court, what do you think that the NCAA could properly restrict students from licensing their names, images, and likenesses?
Under the injunction, we would seek, yes, we specifically limited our proposed injunction to only focus on compensation for athletic services, for generating the revenues. We specifically made it clear we were raising no issue about names, images, and likenesses. I would say, though, Your Honor, that I do believe the California Act and the NCAA response to that act destroys the whole factual predicate of O'Bannon, because what the Board of Governors of the NCAA did is they unanimously stated there will now be some names, images, and likeness payments. We don't know how much or what they're going to allow, but that was their unanimous proclamation. And in O'Bannon, and I know Your Honor knows this very well, they said anything paid for names, images, and likenesses would be that quantum leap. So they have jumped right off that cliff, Your Honor, with respect to that. Unless Your Honor has questions, I do want to save a little rebuttal time.
Certainly.
Thank you.
Mr. Waxman?
A line that the NCAA draws and that this court in O'Bannon recognized over and over again was that it is not pay for play, although educational, the payment for legitimate and actual educational expenses, which includes both academic expenses and for student athletes, the expenses in connection with their athletic participation, is not pay for play, prohibited.
With respect, Mr. Waxman, Judge Wilkin was very skeptical of the slogan that you've just indicated, because in fact, if they don't play, they don't get anything. They don't get scholarships, they don't get any of these things. And there are increased things they're getting. For example, the insurance that we just talked about. They can get that. It's important to them because they may be injured, they may never be able to play pro football or whatever. Isn't Judge Wilkin correct that, although it got a ring to it, that pay for play, no pay, no play kind of thing is really not accurate.
So it pay for play is a shorthand way of characterizing the following rule, which was in existence all the way back at time of Board of Regents, was recognized and approved as pro-competitive in O'Bannon, and it is this. No college student who is an athlete can receive any compensation on account of his or her participation in an NCAA sport except, and this is reflected in the rules since going back 50 years, the reimbursement or payment for, as this court in O'Bannon said, actual educational expenses. In other words, all payments that make it cost-free for a college student to be able to attend and participate. It is what Judge O'Bannon did not appreciate was that that line is the line that defines the amateurism principle in the intercollegiate context. She imposed an injunction that basically says the NCAA must permit conferences and schools to provide any benefit that can be related to education, and that is, and I'm quoting from, I believe, paragraph 2 of her injunction, not included in the cost of attendance. The cost of attendance, as defined in the U.S. Code and the implementing regulations and the NCAA's rules, includes everything that it costs to be a student abroad, to get the equipment that you need, to get tutoring that you need. This is what she did, was impose an obligation on the NCAA to permit any payments that are somehow, quote, related to education that go beyond the actual legitimate cost. That's the in hec verba terms of her paragraph 2. Now, the notion that my friend says, and Judge Wilkin also found, which is, well, you know, the amounts that student athletes have been able to get has increased over time without any depreciable decrease in consumer interest is, of course, unsurprising, because every single one of those benefits, and I'll address the $50,000 loss of value insurance, every single one of those benefits fits within those three, if you will, exceptions to the no compensation for athletic play. And so, of course, it was to be expected that it would not decrease consumer interest in this product. Now, as to this $50,000, the NCAA rules have long permitted athletes to borrow against future earnings in order to purchase disability insurance. Loss of value is a relatively new product that is a form of disability insurance. The NCAA rules have also long allowed the Student Assistance Fund to be used, and we're talking about a couple $100,000 that go to each school every year for all of its Division I athletes, in circumstances to purchase disability or loss of value insurance. That is not a payment to the student. That is essentially payment to insure against a contingency that might make it too risky for a student athlete to participate.
Mr. Waxman, does that money that gets paid from the NCAA to a university, does every athlete in the school get that benefit, or just some athletes?
So each conference sort of enforces the application. All the reporting goes to the conferences in the NCAA.
Right.
But it is provided to the school for the stated benefits for all athletes. The school doesn't have to divide it equally. Obviously, if you're getting a couple $100,000 and you're buying a $50,000 disability policy, it's not happening.
So it's fair to say that it's likely going to go to the perhaps most prominent athletes who are most likely to be concerned about losing athletic ability due to injury. Is that fair?
I think that is. There's nothing in the record on this, and I think from
I'm
what
just
I...
I'm thinking common
it
sense.
Is, no. Yeah. Quite to the contrary. The number of instances that the record shows in which this $50,000 or $40,000 policy has been purchased is infinitesimally small, but the rules permit it. And let me, if I may, just close with the following thoughts. I just want to make clear that in addition to the error of law we think that the judge made in not accepting as pro-competitive our product, the district judge also erred in proclaiming, in divining a new line that divides college athletes from professional athletes, that is, that one receives unlimited pay and one doesn't, which is utterly without basis in the record, is contrary to O'Bannon, and is demonstrably wrong, because professional athletes do not receive unlimited pay. The line O'Bannon drew was between an amateur and a, quote, poorly paid professional. Secondly, even if you overlook the fact that this line that the court divined without any basis in the record, with respect to her less restrictive alternative, there is no evidence in the record, none, that her less restrictive alternative would be remotely as effective in preserving the true distinction, that is, that athletes not be paid, that is recognized and enforced in O'Bannon. And here's my last point. The line that she drew between people getting unlimited payments and not unlimited payments would not even be honored by her injunction, because her injunction, for the reasons I've articulated, puts no limit whatsoever on what a college or Nike or a local booster could promise or pay an athlete for a post-eligibility internship. It puts no limit on tangible benefits. It puts no limit on foreign travel. And therefore, it would make amateur collegiate athletes into much more than the poorly paid professionals that this court in O'Bannon said would be a quantum leap. Thank you.
Thank you. Put 3 minutes on.
Thank you,
we'll,
Your Honor.
We'll even out the time.
First, with all due respect to counsel, that misstated the court's injunction. She listed very specific educational benefits that would be allowed, and then invited the parties if they wanted to suggest any others or to modify the list. It is not an unlimited list. It can't be an automobile. It has nothing to do with Nike. She only put a limit on what the schools could provide. She did nothing to touch the rules relating to outsiders. So that's just a misstatement of her injunction. Second, it is not correct that the record indicates that this payments above cost of attendance were limited to just a few stars who received the loss of value insurance. In fact, what the record is, and this is in our brief, is at least 4,000 athletes, 3,000 in the Power Five, 10,000 outside, have received significant payments above cost of attendance, making that quantum leap with no evidence of injury to demand.
Was that in the record for the district court?
Yes, it is, Your Honor. And we cited that on page 17 and 18 with the ER sites of our first brief in this matter. You will see that. You also will see, Your Honor, that in the testimony of Mr. Lennon, their 30B6 witness, he, on the issue of what the purposes were of the rules, he admitted under oath that many of the benefits they allow have nothing to do with education and have nothing to do with their collegiate model. And then the 30B6 witnesses admitted with no adverse effect on demand. So the problem with their counsel's portrayal is that the record facts didn't support any of this. And finally, on the conferences being able to do this, every single NCAA witness testified the conferences would do the right thing. Their expert, Professor Elsinger, testified that conferences would do the right thing. Our experts testified, Dr. Knoll and Dr. Rasher, the conferences would do the right thing. This record was so different from O'Bannon on this point. It was so one-sided.
What is the right thing?
The right thing is what every competitor does in a competition. You decide your behavior based on what's demand-enhancing. If you're a conference, you're not going to allow spending on athletes that will decrease consumer demand because you are motivated by those billions of dollars in revenue. So, and what the judge said is she said, I think they'll do that, but it'll be a trial and error process to decide what's the right point, and maybe they'll make a mistake. That, Your Honors, is competition. That's exactly what National Society of Professional Engineers and FTC versus Indiana Dentist says we must allow. So the correct injunction, we believe, is let competition decide this. We trust competitors to make the right decision. And if we're not going to do that, Congress has to decide to create an exception to not have competition decide that, not the courts. Unless you have any other questions, Your Honor, I think I covered it.
Thank you, counsel. Thank you all for your arguments today and your briefing. I know you came a long way. It's an important case, and you came a long way under some trying travel times. So we very much appreciate all of that. The case just argued will be submitted for decision.
Thank you, Your Honor.
We'll be in recess.